Beautiful day it is out there, he said in Spanish. Beautiful day. The strange man began humming a spellbinding melody that moved the air around me. He took off his bandit straw hat, fanned his face 5 or 6 times with it, and rested it on his knee. He was sweating. I could see a sheet in the dark, and his smile, the little I could see of it, was one of eerie mischief. His clothes fit tightly on his lean body, ordinary jeans and a light t-shirt, black shoes. His neck was weighed down with gold chains, heavy with machetes and praying hands and pointing fingers. These details came to light as the first feathers of dawn started to fan in through a window above me, bathing him in smoky light, slowly bringing him into focus. He smelled of sweat and vanilla, a mysterious haze of smoky aromas arrived with him, colors perceived with a sense of scent. My head filled manically with the aromas, my newly awakened nose afire with the deep musk and flowers that surrounded me. The bitter odors turned sweet from dark to light and vice versa, the sweeter ones to sweetness beyond description. I held my arm out to him and he scrambled to his feet. He stood up quickly, too quickly in fact, to introduce himself, his cunning leaping before him. It was while he approached me that I noticed he was dark, very dark, that his eyes were different. One was as brown as his skin, the other a blue that had been dulled over by a gray and milky glaze. Taken aback by a sudden jump forward, I moved back and he returned to his chair. He crossed his legs lazily and lit a cigarette. Through a screen of smoke that eclipsed his face, he added, "Okay, I'll tell you my name. It's Jesus, except that I came to ask you for forgiveness this time." With a wide smile that cut his face in half, he threw his arms in the air and shouted, "I promise I'll never do it again. Forgive me, Papi." He bared teeth of silver and gold and laughed so deeply and terribly that I thought I would cough to death. Yet death had no power over this ageless man. He would cough to death, rather. His infectious laughter spilled forth with no hope of subsiding. His legs went askew on the floor and smoke pumped from his nostrils and mouth. He scooped his genitals by sliding one hand down his jeans and threw his other hand at me as if to say, "Never mind, forget about it." Without warning, he went divinely quiet. During the sudden and awkward silence, I could hear the first whispers of another oncoming attack. The more he held it back, the more momentum it gathered. His hyena-like spasms erupted again for odd fractions of an hour until silence once again came over him like a falling drape. I focused all my attention toward him and thought, "I'm not sure what I expected, but you at least owe me the courtesy of respect." My thought was yet another source of wild humor to this odd man. Back went his head and his teeth shone like coins. The pink mouth cracked open as wide as a tiger's. His nostrils ran wet with sniffles and his immortal eyes, eyes that had seen the splendor and misery of ages, became wet with jollity. While dabbing them dry with a red and white bandana, he looked me straight in the face and said, "I've heard that one before." He put his hands over his ears, shook his head violently, dropped his hands to his lap and said, "Come sit. You must be exhausted, poor fellow. Come sit." He applauded himself amidst another storm of hoarse laughter that shook the room, his volcanic fits never to be forgotten. After a few minutes, he became quite serious and said, "Let's go to the other room, you and me, come." He picked up a suitcase that had escaped my scrutiny, and I followed him into the hallway that was being painted with the pale blue dawn. Pointing his finger up at the ceiling, my jolly host declared, "First impressions are not reliable. They're as random as anything else. I've met people I wanted to trust, only to discover they were cheats and thieves and empty of compassion. And some who disgusted me at first sight rose in rank to near holiness." We entered a room of carved stone, floor, walls, vaulted ceiling. My host lit some candles and set them on the floor around us. I saw random drops of fresh blood on the floor and smelled the twilight world between life and death on the air around me. It reminded me of a building I'd once been in. Smiling, he said, "Strange you should remember that. That's why starting over is such a wonderful thing." He placed his fragrant hands on my head and massaged it. Each limb of my body went through his hands in a quick sweep. Sensation returned to my fingers, to my legs. I could feel the pull of gravity through my bones and the feeling of a stone floor against the skin of my feet. My fingers and toes felt each other side by side, and I felt the sensation of cold overtake me. The room had been cold, yet I hadn't felt it. My host put his hands on my shoulders and backed me up against the wall. "You're almost done," he said. He retreated to his suitcase, opened it, and pulled out small glass bottles filled with dark liquids. "Lion's musk should suit you nicely," he said, as he approached me. He splashed the palm of his hand with rivers of dark oil. He rubbed his palms together, placed them on my head, slid my eyelids closed, and said, I give you the power of thought and wisdom. As he said this, my head filled with flickering light, and my young mind was overcome by a flood of knowledge and philosophies, poetry. I saw strange images of many different lives. Were they all mine at one point, or just fragments of a crammed and convoluted consciousness? I saw the exotic women of dusty lands bathing in rivers, men wailing on the high seas, young and dark boys spearing boar-like creatures in a jungle. People I didn't know, whom I could not place anywhere historically, colors I had no names for, forms with definite and simple shapes that eluded even the simplest description flashed through me. He went on, I now give you the power to feel. He rubbed more of the oil into his hands and placed them to my chest. His hands were hot. Falling through a bottomless sky of emotions, my skin crept with waves of fear and terror, my heart grew heavy with sorrow, and my head became light with vast exaltation. I felt the anguish of love lost and the radiance of love realized at the same time. Confusion, anger, longing, adoration, contempt, and remorse all took hold of me. Tears streamed from my eyes, saliva and foam from my lips, my knees shook with weakness, and my recesses sweated the stench of fear. My chest relaxed with relief, and my arms felt devoid of cruel loneliness, which my host moved forward to fill. I realized I was naked, as was he. Had I been wearing clothes at all? Surrounding me, his shoulders above mine, his aroma an animal musk of its own, he planted his lips onto mine and blew air into and through me. This caused the candles around us to conflagrate. Their flames grew by threefold, and that was when I realized we were standing in the center of an abandoned and half-destroyed church, its gothic windows pale in the fire glow, section of stone missing from the wide vaults of the ceiling. I coughed my way back to life as my heart began to beat on its own. It was then that he whispered, I now give you the power to pay tribute to me always and forevermore. His oily hands slithered around the last part of me to come to life, while he grunted like a feeding beast. His lips wrapped around mine and brought back my sense of taste. His hands continued to slide about me, ensuring that my new body was equipped to provide my soul and his engorged godliness with everlasting pleasure. Growling from the core of my soul's new home, I put my lips to his skin, fell to my knees before him, and was barely able to murmur, oh my God, with my new voice, which fused with a wet scream that was born at my throbbing core. Thank you.